All right, I won't push you to become a premium member. I won't push you to shop on Amazon. You know the drill. Let's just get right to the show. Welcome to the show. Well, this is always my favorite part of the week when Frank Conniff and Colleen Worthman stop by and I can check out and not have to do anything. Colleen Worthman is a brilliant comedy writer, actress, and human being. Frank Conniff is also a brilliant actress.
I do all the things.
I think we go up for the same roles all the time.
I do all the things she does except mediocre.
You are on John Fugelsang's Daily Show on Sirius
XM.
I am. What channel?
Channel 121.
Channel 121, and you're on The Nightly Show with Larry Wilmore.
That's correct.
Frank Conniff, if people want to follow you on Twitter, how do they do that?
Frank Conniff, and on Facebook, and they can go to my website too, frankconniff.com.
And you write once a week, twice a week, you'll write a brilliant, what I call a column for Facebook.
Yeah, I've been doing these silly little essays.
They're brilliant.
Oh, thank you. That I've been writing. I've been taking each one of the Republican nominees and writing a little essay. And I've done all of them now, except for I still have John Kasich and Carly Fiorina, I think.
Saving the best for last.
Yeah, and Jim Gilmore, who I don't even know if I'm going to write about or not. But
the former Virginia governor?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So, so I have a bunch of them, and, you know, they're just little fun, little silly 500-word things, you know.
Frank Conniff, Frank Conniff, Frank Conniff. His tweets are beyond brilliant.
They're terrific.
And he comes by them honestly. It's genetic with Frank Conniff.
You know, I'm known as the fat Irishman. I steal everything from everybody. I hope that doesn't. I can say that here because I know no one's listening.
Oh, well, CAA is going to scoop you right up.
Yeah, I was thinking I could get signed by CAA if I stopped writing original tweets. You know.
Well, don't trash CAA. Uh-huh. They had the courage a month ago to drop Bill Cosby.
Oh, wow. Well,
That was very
courageous indeed.
And Colleen Worthman, how do people follow you on Twitter and Facebook?
I am on Twitter at C. Worthman. That's CWERTHMANN.
Not C. Wordman.
No. That's not my last name, you see.
I know, but if your hearing is shot, it sounds like your name is C. Wordman.
But I assume that because this is a podcast, most of your listeners have fairly decent hearing.
Yeah.
I'm going to forge ahead with that assumption.
But horrible taste.
In the which case, please follow me on Twitter at C. Worthman. Again, that's CWERTHMANN, like in Nancy.
Oh, I'm so happy to see you guys. I want to talk today about what's the matter with Kansas versus what's the matter with Kansas City. Mm-hmm. Has anybody talked about this on The Nightly Show?
What's going on in Kansas City?
Well, we talk a lot about how Kansas votes against its own economic interests.
Mm-hmm. As does a lot of the country.
Right.
It's just a most
vis-a-vis the brilliant book written by Thomas Frank,
yes,
formerly of The Baffler, which is a late, great sort of quarterly, I don't know what you would call it.
Yeah.
Most of our country votes against its own interests. Large part of our country does.
Right.
Yeah.
And we're finding out that in Kansas City, where there's a lot of black people,
everything's up to date, I heard.
That perhaps black people vote against their own economic interests. The Black Lives Matters people have been interrupting Bernie Sanders and screaming, this isn't about economic opportunity. Mm-hmm. This is about racism.
Mm-hmm.
And on the way over here, I want to throw this out and talk to you about this. On the way over here, as an East Coast intellectual effete snob, I make fun of Kansas. I say, oh, these idiots, they're only concerned about the American flag and Planned Parenthood, and they only care about their guns. But meanwhile, all their jobs are being sent overseas. And as you said, what's the matter with Kansas? I read that book 15, 12 years ago. And I go, these morons. And then I see the Black Lives Matters people interrupting Bernie, who is this Brooklyn Jew from Vermont running for office, addressing the real issue that's going to help all of America, and it's economic issues. Folks, a rising tide lifts all boats. What are black people worried about? I'm going to get elected president, and there are going to be jobs, and there's going to be tariffs, and black people are going to be working again.
Well, I can't imagine a better result of this upcoming election for black people than Bernie Sanders getting elected.
But
that's
the question
I found... the whole interrupting him thing. And a lot of my progressive friends were supportive of it, but I just thought it was really just the way progressives have a tendency to just circle the wagons and fire at each other, you know.
Are black people, and Colleen,
you're black.
You have your finger on the pulse of black America.
Mm-hmm. As a white woman who writes for Larry Wilmore, indeed.
Have you talked about black people, African Americans?
We had two Black Lives Matter activists on our show this week.
Okay. Did you talk about what's the matter with Kansas City? Why are black people now voting? Because I happen to agree with Black Lives Matters.
Wait, hold on.
You talk about black people voting against their own economic interests by interrupting Bernie Sanders?
Well, you're assuming that that means that they're voting against their own economic interest. What happened is not necessarily that they're anti-Bernie, but they feel like, my sense is that part of the reason that they are going hard at Bernie and Democratic candidates is because they feel like they'll actually listen instead of being called like thugs and getting arrested, you know.
But the problem with that, though, is that they end up hurting Bernie, you know. And
I mean, what was it effective?
Well, everybody says, oh, he appointed a black spokesperson like 3 days later or
Sanders.
Something. And that's fine. But on the other hand, it's presenting his campaign it's focusing his campaign on something when he was on Meet the Press the other day with that great journalist Chuck Todd, Chuck Todd just wanted to talk about that. He didn't want to talk about all the other anti-Wall Street message and all the other things that Bernie Sanders has to talk about. They want to focus on there was conflict. Oh, there was like a thing. So the media focuses on that. And on the one hand, okay, maybe that shines a light on the Black Lives Matter movement. But on the other hand, it hurts Bernie's campaign, I think. Everyone who supports the things that Bernie believes in should be supporting his campaign. And I'm saying, and I'm a Hillary supporter, but I'm saying that was bad for Bernie.
Okay, it was bad for Bernie. Colleen Worthman.
Yeah.
Bad for Bernie. Why are Democrats so frightened of honest debate? The Republicans who are winning.
Not winning.
Well, hang on for 1 second. The Republicans have been having a nervous breakdown since 2000. And it's fractured, and there's a civil war within the Republican Party.
The South is winning, I assume.
Yes. Every 4 years, the smug white intellectuals on the East Coast say, oh, look at those Republicans.
Like I just did 2 seconds ago.
Yeah, look at their nervous breakdown. Uh-huh. Can you believe 20 people want to debate on Fox News and they only have room for 10? And look at how Trump is attacking everybody. They're going to have, and they have real good, healthy as a Republican can be, debate. And they win. They win in the Senate. They win in the Congress. They win in the state houses. They don't win presidential elections.
They win in the state houses because they're better organized,
like,
and because they the groups like the Tea Party and the religious right are much better at getting out the vote on a local level. And the problem with liberals is they don't give a shit about midterm elections and local elections, which are actually just as important as the presidential election, but people shrug it off, and also they have gerrymandering on their side, and that's why they win the local houses. But on a national level, they are totally not winning.
On a national level, they are not winning, and you're absolutely right, Colleen Worthman. If there were honest debate in the Democratic Party, which we don't have. We have this fear of 1972, a fractured Democratic Party, because there's so many ethnicities and sexual interests. Don't you think that Democrats are so afraid of the Democratic Party being fractured by honest debate that it's Humpty Dumpty? They could never put the Democratic Party back together again. So you just go with a neoliberal like Hillary, and you don't really pay attention to what she's saying. Or if you like Bernie, don't challenge Bernie. Don't open up the Pandora's box of Democratic special interests, because we will never, ever be united again. Aren't we afraid of honest debate? And
I mean, I think so. You know, I feel like pretty much there are as many striations in the Democratic Party as there are in the Republican Party, you know? The only difference is more people on that side are willing to go all in right now. Whereas
what side?
On the Republican side. And because Hillary has been around so long and she's such a juggernaut, I think specifically in this election cycle, that's why people are reluctant to go in. I mean, Gillibrand could have run, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Who else?
Elizabeth Warren.
Right. She could have. And they're like, nah, I'm not even trying to mess with
Or Joe Biden.
With Hillary.
He could have run.
Yeah, he could have.
But
do you think, Frank Conniff, do you think we would be we being Democrats, would be better off with our gerrymandering and in our state houses and being able to play the micro game if we were energized by debate?
Well, I mean,
I don't know where
the debate. I think within our if you contrast the Democratic contenders and the Republican contenders, I think on the Democratic side you have intelligent differences between the candidates. You have Bernie Sanders and you have Hillary Clinton, who is actually moving further to the left, probably because of Bernie Sanders.
Mm-hmm.
So that's a healthy thing. That he's in the contest, and she's and it's making her move further to the left. So that's a much more intelligent kind of discourse that's going on in there, as opposed to the Republican Party. You know, where it's just insanity,
making
you know?
Pot shots about wearing hearing aids and whatnot.
Yeah, you know. So I don't really see. I think a lot of when people talk about the disarray in the Democratic Party, people talk about Hillary's campaign being in big trouble. That's all kind of bullshit. It's not really true.
I think people are just desperate to fill the
the
sun-setting 24-hour cable news.
Yes,
cycle.
and the whole thing of like Joe Biden might run for president is complete bullshit. He's not running for president. Maureen Dowd made up a conversation in her mind that he had with his dying son, and
it should have been awful.
Yeah, it should have just been left at that. But then everyone in the media was like, "Hey, Joe Biden is running," and I knew that there was an actual supposed real news column about a news story about it in the Times, besides the Maureen Dowd column. And then when I finally read the New York Times story, they quoted as their source, Maureen Dowd's column was their source. So it's, you know, the
Maureen Dowd's column should never be a source for anything or anyone.
Yes, exactly. She's a broken, you know, horrible writer.
Oh, I don't know.
Yes.
Yes.
I've never made
worst.
A truer statement than Maureen Dowd is a fucking horrible writer.
Word up.
She's like a pastry. She's fun to read. It's light.
How is she fun to read?
No. She's like a dry croissant that makes you cough.
Exactly. Yeah, she's just I can
flaky in all the wrong ways.
Oh, flaky. And plus, you know, her last she's never written a nice word about Hillary Clinton, about Barack Obama, about Al Gore. She's just written three fawning columns in a row about Donald Trump.
She's still patting herself on the back for comparing him to Spock. It's like people did that like 30 seconds after he
And Donald
a
Trump
senator.
Just said you know, Maureen Dowd is great. She did me a big favor. So how can anybody take her seriously after that? It's amazing to me that out of everyone, the journalist who's been toughest on Trump is Megyn Kelly on Fox.
And what does that say about the right wing?
No, what does it say about our media? What does it say about our mainstream media that Fox and Chris Wallace asked some tough questions too? Mm-hmm. Since then, Trump is getting such gigantic ratings for people that all anyone wants to do is do a fawning interview with him, pretend to ask him a tough question.
It's incredibly cynical.
Yeah, without asking him a tough question so that he won't get pissed off, so that he'll come back on their show and they can keep getting big ratings, so that they'll keep their access.
Well, would you be willing to admit, Colleen Werthmann, that Fox News, despite its right-wing propaganda, that if you watch Bret Baier, that they are the best news organization
out
there?
I wouldn't say that.
What kind of primrose path are you trying to
I'm talking about vis-a-vis MSNBC and CNN. In other words...
I thought they did a good job with the debate.
Job with the debate. You can see Ralph Nader on Fox News. You can see Medea Benjamin on Fox News. Mm-hmm. You cannot see them on CNN.
No.
Or MSNBC, which MSNBC, by the way, has become one 24-hour infomercial for Donald Trump, except for like maybe Rachel Maddow's show. But every other show is just
agreed,
jumping on the Trump bandwagon big time.
Except for Melissa Harris Perry.
Yeah, Melissa Harris Harry and Rachel.
Harry?
Melissa Harris.
Melissa Harris Perry, MHP.
I like the other way.
Melissa Harris Harry, I don't.
I want to ask you a question about Jon Stewart. Fair and balanced news.
He was actually at our studio yesterday.
Really?
Yeah, because we just had our 100th episode. And he, since he's one of our executive producers, he popped by. We sort of had an all-hands meeting in the studio. And, you know, Rory Albanese, our showrunner, was like, congratulations, you guys. It's a lot of hard work. Have a great break. And then Larry thanked us all. He gave a really lovely speech about, you know, how hard everyone's been working. And then Jon Stewart talked to us, and he said that he, quote unquote, is so fucking angry at us for finding our voice so quickly. It was really touching. It was beautiful.
That's great. Yeah. Great. Does he have a beard?
He's got some stubble. Mm-hmm. He looked pretty exhausted, truth be told. I think just he's still decompressing.
Yeah. So he went after a show called Crossfire in 2003 or 2004.
Long time ago,
2003. Now, Crossfire was a show on CNN.
Mm-hmm.
And John gets a lot of credit for getting Crossfire taken off the air.
Mm.
I maintain that was a disservice to journalism. I thought Crossfire was one of the best shows on television at the time. The only place you could hear in 2003 anti-war opinion was on Crossfire.
Mm-hmm.
That there was actually honest debate on Crossfire.
I don't remember that.
Yeah, I don't remember that either.
I don't know why he targeted Crossfire. It was the
any show that's co-hosted by Tucker Carlson
that's
is well worth targeting.
He was right for calling.
And what he was saying,
that guy's the worst. He's like Mr. Potato Head.
Yeah. And what he said about Crossfire, he was really saying about all of the media and everything he said about Crossfire then is true to an even much larger degree now about the entirety of the mainstream media.
Like, have you ever read that George Saunders essay, The Brain Dead Megaphone?
No, I don't think so.
It's a fucking fantastic essay about just kind of how degraded our journalism has become, TV journalism specifically. Where like the dumbest thing gets the loudest voice. I mean, and it's perfectly true.
It's only gotten more and more true.
Why are you looking at me when you say that?
You know what you did.
Who was George Saunders?
George Saunders.
Who was George Saunders?
He played Addison DeWitt in All About Eve. Oh, no, you're talking about George Saunders.
He is one of my absolute favorite authors. Have you ever read him?
I think he wrote a really good suicide note, or am I thinking of somebody else?
No, that's George Saunders.
Oh, that's my favorite author.
George Saunders, who played Addison DeWitt in All About Eve, wrote a suicide note saying, I'm bored, I'm out of here, basically.
Awesome.
Which is what a lot of my listeners are doing right now.
Please pen that note immediately.
And have the courage to follow through with it.
Here, you know what, I'll write it for you.
Okay, so, all right, so who is George Saunders and who is George Saunders?
We already,
we've established very well.
I don't know
for the all your listeners who are from the 1800s can appreciate a good George Saunders joke.
Okay.
Hey, I've got a main of them.
And who is Bernie Sanders? Okay.
Can I get a motherfucking word in edgewise?
Yes, you can.
George Saunders is a absolutely brilliant author. He wrote a book called Pastoralia. He wrote one called Civil War Land and Bad Decline. Their books, they tend to be short stories.
Mm-hmm.
Short to medium length.
Fiction writer.
Yeah, fiction writer. He actually teaches at Syracuse. Mm-hmm. And he just
came out. Oh, he's still alive?
Oh, yeah.
Oh.
Yeah.
Okay.
And last year he came out with this book called 10th of December, which is fucking
that was
spectacular.
Like this big breakthrough book.
So
kind
amazing.
Kind of a bestseller even.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah, it was great. I have it. I haven't read every story in it, but I've read several of them.
He has, a lot of his characters write in a kind of bad business English, or they, like their narrative voice mm-hmm. is like a bad business English that's shitty and degraded.
Mm-hmm.
And he uses a lot of, he's obsessed with like how people take medicines to control their personalities mm-hmm. and their lives. And his stories are funny and crazy in a very quiet, sad, quotidian way.
Mm-hmm.
I absolutely love his writing.
Great. Great. All right. The Black Lives Matters. Mm-hmm. Thank you for that.
Sure thing.
Thank you. Black Lives Matters. Are black people, African Americans, wrong for saying... And thank God we don't have any African-Americans here.
To add some insight.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think we're best qualified to speak on this issue.
Well, we are, because I'm a paternalistic Jew, so I like to tell people what's good for them.
I'm an aggressive Irish-German.
And I find that when I'm around, black people always feel good about themselves.
You're upset with the Black Lives Matter.
I'm not upset. I just disagree with that mythology.
Can you separate racism from economic oppression? Is there something different?
No, racism, it would seem to me, and I really am not qualified to talk about it.
Well, you're that. A racist.
Yes. As a racist, I can say that racism and economic matters go very much hand in hand.
Ah,
yes.
And I am learning that you're wrong. Mm-hmm. And that's what Black Lives Matters is trying to teach
it's actually
us.
Black Lives Matter, no S on the end.
I'm a part of a different...
Oh, this is the Splinter Group?
This is the Splinter Group.
So you don't think racism plays any part in the economic suppression of a certain... group of people.
Here's something I would posit.
Uh-huh.
I haven't used that word in like 12 years. Wow. Not all racism is economic oppression, but all economic oppression is racist.
All economic oppression is racist.
Think about redlining, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Think about even how hard it is for many black homeowners to get home insurance, you know?
Yeah.
That shit is still happening.
Mm-hmm. All right, so I interviewed, and I really recommend everybody listen to this interview that I did with Justin Gifford. He's the, and you should have him on the show. He wrote the new book, Street Poison, the biography of Iceberg Slim.
Oh.
Have you had him on the show yet?
No.
Oh, my God, you should have him on the show. He's brilliant. He's a professor of literature out of the University of Reno. Wrote an amazing book about Iceberg Slim, who I knew nothing about until Jerry Stahl turned me on to him. And Iceberg Slim was a pimp.
Who wrote an incredible autobiography about his time as a pimp and in prison.
Yeah.
Yeah, I read that years ago. I actually was in a play based on it.
What did you play one of the...
It was called Lady Pimp. It was a very crazy play, but it was inspired by that book.
Lady?
Yeah,
lady?
I played the Lady Pimp. It was great.
And did you have a stable of men or women?
Women.
So you were a madam?
No, I was a lady pimp.
And you worked the streets?
No, it was kind of like a weird monologue with like chime-ins. I don't remember it terribly well. It was a short play, but it was very fun and funny.
Okay. I want to get back to, he was Professor Gifford, and everybody should pick up this book, Street Poison. It's the biography of Iceberg Slim.
There's a documentary about him out, too.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's easier to do.
Yeah, that's what I watched, so I don't need to read the book now.
He says that during Jim Crow, while there was economic incentive to create separate but equal, It was about racism, pure and simple.
Mm-hmm.
That the redlining, that the creation of ghettos was set up to keep black people away from white people.
Yeah.
That the legislation, local legislation that put prostitution in the ghetto, they would enforce prostitution laws in white neighborhoods. It was against the law in white neighborhoods, but they let it thrive in the ghetto.
Yeah.
They let drug deals go down in the ghetto, but not
in... It sounds like an Elvis Presley song.
Yes, in the white neighborhoods, drug deals were illegal.
In because,
not for economic reasons at the beginning, but because they wanted to establish the ghetto as the font of vice. They wanted people to perceive black people...
Black neighborhood equals bad neighborhood.
Not for economic reasons.
Right.
Purely racist reasons. So, Frank, black people, I'm beginning to understand, think racism is separate from lack of economic opportunity.
I still don't agree with that, because even if you're creating ghettos based on racism, the economic hardships that come to them, the opportunities that are denied to them from coming from those ghettos comes from the racism that made their, if what you're saying is true, it comes from the racism that made the ghetto happen in the first place. And then that's affecting their economic climb and their social climb and their ability to rise in the society. So even if what you say is true, that still doesn't mean that in this day and age, as a result of all that, that racism and economic issues are not completely tied in with each other.
Right. And what I'm beginning to learn, Colleen Werthmann, is that Bernie Sanders, a Brooklyn Jew, I know the type. The problem between blacks and Jews is Jews are often perceived in the black community as paternalistic. And we have a tendency, I'm not saying all Jews, and it's a miscommunication, but this is just some of the problems between blacks and Jews. That Jews tell black people what they should be afraid of and concerned about. And Jews like Bernie Sanders and me, although I'm learning, and Frank, you're an honorary Jew after that last statement.
I thought being a comedian made me an honorary Jew.
That we're
also that.
We're saying to black people, you don't understand. Your feelings aren't legitimate. You need to be concerned about economic issues and not racism. We're going to teach you.
I think they should be concerned about racism totally, but I don't think Bernie Sanders is their problem. You know, there are people running for president of the United States who are overt, outright, unapologetic racists. Out of all those people, why is Bernie Sanders their focus?
Because he is supposed to be their savior. He's a white Jew from Brooklyn who moved to Vermont.
Savior according to whom? Savior according to whom?
He thinks of himself.
Okay.
And I do, too, as the savior for the blacks.
He looks at himself as a fighter and
for everybody.
An advocate for progressive issues, which I think will help everybody. And I think it'll help blacks. And it's not to say that black people don't have a legitimate issues about this. But my point is, why is he the target? He's not the target.
To be fair, they've been targeting other people as well. There are a bunch of Black Lives Matter people. The two activists who were on our show this week tried to interrupt a Hillary Clinton campaign event in New Hampshire, and they were intercepted by the Secret Service.
Right.
But then Hillary met with them backstage, and they filmed it.
Right.
It's a 10-minute-long video.
In that video, Hillary Clinton said something that was really great.
Yeah. I don't believe in changing hearts.
The guy says, "How are you going to change people's hearts?" And she says, I don't think I can change people's hearts. I have to change the structure and the laws and the world we live in."
I love that.
Yeah.
It was
so smart.
It's a very that 10-minute video is well worth watching.
That is I remember Dennis Miller saying, Oof. To me that, you know, I just don't believe racism can ever be eradicated. And I remember saying to him, that's why we needed Brown v. Board of Education. You have to, the government mm-hmm. can dictate behavior. You can right. you can be yeah. a racist.
You can still be a racist, but you can't.
But you can't force me to go to an inferior school.
Right. Or not live in your apartment building. Mm-hmm. If because you're a racist, you prevent me from living in your apartment building, then you're breaking the law.
Okay, back to racism. This mm-hmm. is really important to me because I'm learning. And Colleen Worthman, you work on the Nightly Show. There are a lot of African Americans on board. Racism is a separate issue from economic oppression, and that is what white Jews like Frank Conniff don't get. They don't get it. Why? Why? And I think I'm ahead on the curve, and you're not, Frank. Mm-hmm. I challenge you.
Yeah, I'm completely.
Why are police officers? Mm-hmm. shooting unarmed black men mm-hmm. and not unarmed white men, is that an economic
no,
issue?
No, that's racism. And I'm not saying that racism, just pure racism, doesn't exist. But I'm saying that that the economic issues will be better addressed by Bernie Sanders. And also, it seems to me, he would probably be more inclined to be sympathetic of people who are being shot by cops, of black people who are being shot by cops.
But what's the matter with Kansas City?
Than necessarily, you know what? Kansas City would be, to me, what's the matter with Kansas City would be trying to bring down Bernie Sanders' campaign.
Exactly.
You know?
This is the point I'm trying to make. What's the matter with Kansas City? Frank Conniff.
I'm the matter with it, especially if you saw my set at Stanford and Sons when I performed there.
Frank Conniff, Colleen Worthman, mm-hmm. is saying there's something the matter with Kansas City. We all know there's something the matter with Kansas. What's the matter with Kansas City? Black people, by interrupting Bernie Sanders and focusing
on
racism.
I know, you keep harping on this, but what?
Why are they not only focusing on economic issues? They're voting.
Well, they don't have to only
focus on
issues.
Black Lives Matter is about
issues.
Police murdering mm-hmm. innocent black people.
Yeah.
I would not be surprised if there is an offshoot that is more focused on economic issues. But the point of Black Lives Matter, as I understand it, mm-hmm. is that their focus is, hey, stop murdering us, mm-hmm. period.
Okay. So let me go back to Kansas then.
I disagree with this whole, like, they're voting against their own economic opportunities.
All right, but
principle that
okay,
you
but I that's okay.
Shoving in my face like a flaccid
like
dick.
A bagel. Leave his flaccid dick out of it.
Is this horrible? My girlfriend told me she wanted me to choke her during sex, so I put my dick down. No, okay.
Wow.
Yeah, that was a joke that I came up with, and Alex said, don't tell it. And by the way, we're going to talk about what's the matter with Brooklyn in a second.
What's that joke for? Is it for, like, Penthouse Forum? Or where?
No, it's for being removed from the radio version of this episode.
I just have to tell
click
you.
Click and drag to the trash.
David, that from you, I expect only the highest quality autoerotic jokes. And I say that seriously because he's written some of the best ones that I've heard. So.
Well, I didn't write the best, but you did nail me at QED the other night. You said, how many comics do five separate autoerotic asphyxiation jokes?
But back to back?
Well, he did several of
like
them.
Like a royal flush?
Which I love because then it just inspired me to do mine. joke.
Help me with this joke, and then I want to get back to my stupid premise. My girlfriend wants me to choke her during sex. This is what I have so far, okay. But I don't have the right punchline. Right. My girlfriend wanted me to choke her during sex, so I gave her a chicken salad sandwich with a lot of bones still in it.
That's funny.
Is it?
Yeah.
I like that very much.
Do you? Alex? Yeah. Thumbs up. That's way better. Chicken salad sandwich with a lot of bones in it. Is that funny? And then I Colleen, is this sexist? And then after the laugh, I tag it with, I boned that bitch. Well. Is that sexist?
Okay. You know what I like to...
sorry.
I get off...
What did you do? I boned her lovingly.
I get off on choking during sex. That's why I always have a spelling bee when I'm having sex.
Or I, because you can't answer the...
Yes, because I choke on it. Yeah, I could say a tennis match or whatever, but...
I thought I always...
like a spelling bee.
I choke.
Because there's the idea that there's like an audience, like a judges.
Right.
Someone reading off the words.
You're fucking someone,
so
and
crowded.
You go, use it in a sentence, please.
The best joke. Mm-hmm. Was written 20 years. I worked on Roseanne with a guy named Mike Gandolfi from San Francisco.
Oh, Mike Gandolfi.
You know his?
Oh, I know him very well. I don't know if I know this joke, but I know him.
Did you work on? Did you work on that show when Bobby Gaylor was there?
No.
Okay, he's a writer on our staff.
Oh, say hello to Bobby Gaylor.
Okay, I will.
He should have. He should circumcise his last name.
Indeed, but I'm sorry. You were saying.
Gay. I'm trying to be... See, this is why I love you guys. Let me explain something. We do a lot of shows here at Showbriz Studios.
Yes. Mm-hmm. The elegantly appointed headquarters.
Isn't it great?
Yeah, really nice.
It's fantastic. It's just getting nicer and nicer.
Yeah.
I like shows where I feel safe enough where I can just... like, just
tank.
Fail. Yeah. It's so much more... And I like you guys because you're not afraid of failure.
Mm-hmm. I wrote a thing.
That happens to me a lot.
I wrote a thing for our show the other day just tanked. Like Larry just looked at it and he shook his head and goes, "This is insane." I liked it, but whatever.
I've had more tanks than Rommel.
Failure. Mm-hmm. It was something I wanted to. We'll move on. I want to get back to Kansas City, but I also want to talk about failure. I want to talk about Kansas City before we move on to failure and what's the matter with Brooklyn. That's the second half of our show. How deep are we in here? We need a clock, Mr. Brazil. How are we on time? We're at 36 minute. Okay. Before we get to what's the matter with Brooklyn and failure... Is it fair to say, and I think Obama would say this, that if black people think that there are things that are more important than economic issues, like don't kill our kids, is it fair to say that Kansas should not be mocked for being stupid when they say don't kill our babies? In other words, when we say you're voting against your own, don't you understand that abortion is a wedge issue? You're being tricked into voting for pro-life candidates.
But whatever the black people, whatever problems they might have, they're not necessarily voting against their own interests because the ones that vote tend to vote for Democrats.
Yeah,
you know, so the black people who vote for Republicans are a whole other category of conservative Republicans. But even people who right now might have issues with Bernie Sanders and the way racism is being addressed, the ones who believe in voting next November, they're either going to vote for Hillary Clinton or Bernie Sanders. They're not going to vote for Donald Trump or Scott Walker.
Is that true?
Whoever it's going to be.
I'm disagreeing with your premise yet again. The thing is that when black people say, "Hey, stop murdering us," it's not the same as, "Hey, don't murder our babies." Policemen aren't running up to women's uteruses and shooting them in the uterus,
right.
You know what I mean?
But that would be okay, in a way.
I mean, if it happened to me, I would welcome it.
An unarmed fetus.
Yes. You know?
Yes. Well, I'm just talking about snobbery and elitism. What I'm saying is, and Obama kind of talks about this, or nibbles around the edges of this, and that is, we have a tendency to be smug about Kansas and say, they're so stupid, they only care about abortion, meanwhile, they're being robbed blind. And could it be, excuse me for one second, could you say that these are genuine Christian people who believe money is not the most important thing in the world, that it is family, and when you talk about you know, economic issues and a rising tide lifts all boats, that's irrelevant to my faith. I believe in Christ.
Well, okay.
Well,
so
there are many single-issue voters.
They have a good reason, then, to vote against their own interests. But
their own economic interests.
Yeah, their own economic, if that other stuff is more important. But the other thing I disagree with you, I don't think that this idea of elitism is a big problem in our society.
I would argue that there is scorn and condescension on both sides. Mm-hmm. Right-leaning people hate left-leaning people, mm-hmm. and think that we're fucking idiots, mm-hmm. or snobs, or, you know,
right.
yuppie bullshit cappuccino Volvo drive, mm-hmm. whatever that stereotype was from whatever election cycle that was, whether it was 2012 or 2008.
You lost your train of thought. Let her find it. It's always interesting.
She's finding it, I'll just say that we use the idea. Oh, okay, go ahead.
The idea that "quote unquote" most right wing people are mm-hmm. anti-abortion—that's just not true.
Mm-hmm.
Like it's like 3 or 4%.
Right, right.
You know, like they're the powerful ones. Yeah.
Within the party.
Like the fundamentalist right-wing yeah. Christian people mm. are like a very small component. Mm. Just as like the hyper liberal, you know, people who masturbate to The Nation.
Uh-huh.
Katrina Vandenhoevel.
Pretty hot.
She, don't you think?
Mm-hmm.
I'm just talking about the essays.
I just always make sure I jizz to the left.
Right. You know,
but
the hyper liberals are a small mm. segment. That's all anyone talks about. The hyper conservatives, and you know,
right.
and again, the people who are kind of like, oh, I have one big mm. issue.
Yeah,
they get the megaphone.
They get the megaphone,
just
exactly.
like George Saunders
right.
says.
Yeah, and what were I was going to say too is that your premise that there's this big elitism and smug East Coast thing going on, I think that's a false narrative, and I think
you're shoving all kinds of bullshit yeah. at us today. Just steaming plates.
You know, I was watching.
He's nodding.
That's what I do. That's what this show is.
I was watching Chris Matthews because I have no self esteem, and
did you maybe trip? Yep. In a household
yes,
accident, you gonked
exactly.
your head on a table when you woke up. It was playing.
But
you know that his camera has a windshield wiper on it just to wipe off all the
yes,
spit?
I believe it. But anyway, it was him and Michael Steele and my friend Joan Walsh was on, and they were.
You're friendly with Joan Walsh.
I am friendly with Joan. I really want. I just wanted to work there, and I have nothing else to say. No.
Did she ever find her missing kid?
Joan Walsh.
Oh, that's John.
John.
Sorry. From Salon. Joan Walsh, one of the best writers.
But
in
anyway,
America.
They were talking about how Trump's poll numbers have gone up even after he said all these horrible things. And they showed some focus group of people saying they loved him, you mm-hmm. know. And she was saying, well, these people are like the lowest common denominator. And then they completely berated her for being an elitist. For saying something that is so obviously true,
mm-hmm.
you know, and there's this whole thing in the media of, you know, Obama's an elitist, Democrats are elitists, you know, George W. Bush was just a good old boy. He's a guy you could have a beer with, and there's something preferable to that, to like a smarty pants East Coast person, and it's just all bullshit. Is
okay.
my point.
Colleen?
Yep, agreed.
Colleen, cops.
Mm-hmm.
Shooting unarmed black men.
Mm-hmm.
Black men reach for a wallet, 67 shots.
Mm-hmm.
Is the problem, you said about Hillary, she said, what did she say?
She said you can't change people's hearts, you can change the structure and the laws and the world that their hearts live in.
How do we frame the Black Lives Matters problem? Because it is a problem, because I think...
What do you mean by that?
What I mean is nobody's willing to say this.
And when you say we, who do you mean?
I mean we, the people, America. We will not say what I'm about to say.
Which is?
Because it requires more than a soundbite. If, as Hillary says, you cannot change people's hearts, you cannot change the cops. They are racist, and they are afraid of black men.
Mm-hmm.
Are we wasting time trying to cure racist cops? Wouldn't we be better off treating their fear of the black man? And their fear of the black man is that black men are packing heat. Now, that's not true.
Mm, at least in the instances where they get shot,
right.
It isn't true.
So, you know, here's the problem. You can't talk about this because it can't be reduced to a soundbite. So nobody's going to say this. The problem isn't that black people have guns. The problem is that cops are frightened of getting shot because there are too many guns in this country. Because many cops are stupid and racist, they see all these guns being sold and they figure, well, black people are violent. They're all carrying guns. If they reach for something, it's a gun. Why aren't black people, unarmed black men, getting shot in England or France?
Because there are fewer guns.
Isn't the problem guns?
But that's
guns are certainly an unsolvable problem here. It's a horrible tragedy.
So is racism.
I'm not. You're the one who's saying they're mutually exclusive, David. Why are you? Why are you like making it like it's my fault? What the fuck?
I'm so happy. This makes me so. You know how pathetic
it's
I am.
Profoundly irritating.
You know how sad my life is. This is the highlight of my week. Right, this moment right now, Frank.
Yeah. That's why I always see on the street calling everybody racist. You just want to get our people to talk to you.
Oh God.
Go ahead.
I mean, clearly, racist police practices must be fixed with laws and with better training. And also, guns are a horrible problem in our society. Obviously, we all agree on that.
Right. And there should be more gun control. But that, of all the issues going on, that's the one that's the farthest away from changing ever. Because the fact that police are afraid that black people have guns, that's not going to make there be gun control. If a guy going into a school and shooting 12 kids to death,
and they're never black.
And a guy going into a church, well, in the church they were black. If that's not going to cause gun control, which it hasn't, then I don't.
God help us.
Of everything I can think of, gun control is the one thing we're not going to see changed in our lifetime.
If I were still running for Bill Maher, I would suggest a new rule. Cops have to start shooting
more unarmed white people?
Yeah, because white people are the ones who really are shooting up all the
They are. And, you know, there was all this concern and hyped up fear about that movie Straight Outta Compton that, they increased.
They beefed up
security at movie theaters. And because, you know, all this violence happens during really black films like Trainwreck and
Batman,
The Dark Knight Returns or whatever. It's all of the movie theater violence that's happened has been by white people during white movies.
By the way, did you see Straight Outta Compton?
I did not.
It's really good.
Well, Colors. Remember the movie, the Robert Duvall? There was shooting. That's Sean Penn and Robert Duvall.
Yes.
There were gang shootings back then.
Right, but so, that was like, you know, that was a million years. That was a long time.
That was in like 1991 or something, right?
That's when there was an actual term called going postal.
Yeah. Because of post office.
Because post office workers were the ones doing the shootings.
Mm-hmm. And that is over.
And the worst,
because they solved that problem.
Right. Well, now they have the forever stamps, so. How much does it cost? Forever.
No, they did solve that. They were able to solve postal people going postal.
Well, but there's one bad thing about that is that fewer people are using the word disgruntled, which is something that's bad for our society, I think.
Does it make you gruntled?
Yes. I'm gruntled right now.
I would think gruntled should mean disgruntled. What does disgruntled mean?
I don't know. Gruntled must be good then. Like, you're content.
Yeah. I'm gruntled about this. So you don't think Because I just want to repeat this because I think it's profound. If you cannot change people's hearts, change the laws, get rid of the guns. Get rid of the guns. Now, there's another thing that nobody's talking about.
David Feldman.
Yes, of course. The problem in Ferguson, they say, is the militarization of our police.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Water cannons.
Sound cannons.
Sound cannons and tanks and all this equipment coming back from Iraq and Afghanistan being turned over to our police. Mm-hmm. And President Obama says, we're going to put an end to this. We are not going to turn our police into paramilitary organizations.
Right.
And I say, what the... What are you talking about? Give them everything. Do you know how many guns? So the police are going to be have less fewer arms than these crackpots who are hoarding weapons? I want the police to have all.
But a lot of the crackpots are on the police force, though. It's true. And, you know, I on our radio show the other day, we had Randy Credico, who you probably
love
know.
Randy.
Yeah, Randy's a great guy.
He's still talking right now, as a matter of fact, on your radio show.
Very extremely left-wing, really left-wing. And he is against gun control because he says, if the cops are armed, I want to be armed too. You know, he's, if the cops are going around shooting people, I want to be able to defend myself. And this is just a really extremely left-wing guy who... If you have that vision of our society where we're in a police state where black people and other people have to be worried, then he says, don't take my gun away.
Colleen?
I don't believe that tanks are going to prevent crazy people from shooting things up. I just don't.
Yeah, that's a good point.
But
and I don't think that, you know, turning a police force into a paramilitary organization is a good idea. I mean, it's like a cute take, but I totally disagree with the concept.
I want to go back to the simple days of the platoon on the beat. You know.
Yeah.
Well, if I were a cop
and
I was going out on the street every day.
I can't even get in the fashion police.
If I were going out every day and thinking about...
You would make a terrible policeman.
Really?
Yeah.
I would beat up unarmed white people all the time. I would just
crack them over the head with your nightstick.
If the cops, be honest, if the cops were beating the shit out of entitled white people for being entitled white people, would you be upset?
It would depend on what they were doing.
I'd be upset because my goal is to one day be an entitled white person.
And, when you see a white person driving their Volvo and talking on the phone and texting, don't you think we'd all be better off if a cop pulled them over and just took the phone, shoved it up their ass, and beat the shit out of them?
That would be satisfying on one level, but I think we'd all be better off if the cop pulled them over and arrested them for texting while
I happen to think that Volvos are really nice, safe vehicles.
Mm-hmm.
So the person texting...
As nice as your flannel shirt and Birkenstocks?
Yes.
And the cat fur all over you?
We actually have a Subaru Forester because my husband and I are both lesbians.
Oh, okay.
Well, I would like the cops to be...
If it were like an Audi or a Lexus, I would be more on board with that.
Okay. Pedophilia.
Yay!
We're going to get to Brooklyn and failure, by the way. We will. Mm-hmm. Pedophilia.
Mm-hmm.
I'm just offering up. We have bagels, coffee,
and
orange juice,
and pedophilia.
I'm going to come out right now and say opposed.
Okay.
Rough week. Going to go out on a limb,
yes. Rough week for Jared Fogle.
He can go fuck himself.
Well.
Truly.
If he had done that, he wouldn't be in jail. You know, it's just been a bad week. iTunes.
Did you see the Daily Mail or the Daily News headline?
No.
Subhuman.
Ooh, that's good. All right, kicking a man when he's down on his knees.
Let's kick him. Fuck that guy.
He had a rough week. iTunes turned down his new dating app, Kinder.
And then he tried to become the spokes.
I love that joke. That's fun.
He tried to become the spokesman for Jizz Nose. He turned him down.
Yes. Well...
One of my office mates cracked a joke yesterday. It was like, Quiznos just changed its slogan to, our subs are toasted, and also we don't employ sex perverts.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I have some I want to talk about pedophilia.
Here's the thing, though. I will say this. There is so much hysteria about, he's got child porn, and I do feel like it's a little weird. Like, there is such a, like, in pornography, there's, like, so much, like, teen porn. I feel like, why are we surprised that people want to have sex with teenagers? Like,
and there's a lot of
there's
a lot in our culture of sexualized teenagers, and it's accepted, and it's considered okay, you know. So I'm not advocating
for Jared Fogle fucking child prostitutes, or, you know.
What I find really weird about the whole thing is that he lost a ton of weight so that he'd look good when he was paying for sex.
Yeah, right.
I don't quite understand the logic behind that.
He was
that.
A fat, creepy tool, and then he was just a skinnier, creepy
tool. And then he got thinner,
tool.
And so, you know, when he came up and said, hello, I'd like to buy sex.
Well, we're finding out. Alex Brazell, the owner of Showbiz Studios, says he didn't lose weight from eating Subway. He lost all his weight by giving candy to little boys.
Oh, he gave all his candy.
But
he gave all his candy away.
He didn't. I think girls were his target,
yeah,
not boys.
Yeah, he was into girls. Yeah.
All right.
So he's not a pervert. Come on.
All right. But,
it was girls. It does count.
Yeah.
All right. I got a couple things I want to talk about in terms of pedophilia.
Mm-hmm.
Do we know any good websites?
We just talked about black people and the problem with the police.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And that police are dangerous.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
And the police have to be policed.
Mm-hmm.
Pedophilia in this country, I'm going to guess, is a problem.
Yes.
I used to believe that there was no such thing as child porn, that the FBI was creating honey traps. This was before the internet. This is what I was told by people who I respected. And they said to me, there's no such thing as child porn. Most of it has been produced by the FBI, and it doesn't even exist. The FBI is just trying to lure people into a honey trap.
Where did you read this? On like a GeoCities
homepage? This was First Amendment conventional wisdom up until about the internet. And now the internet, I guess, has planted ideas in people's heads. I mean, I
think the internet is giving people exactly what they want. Like, communities find themselves, you know? There are like whole websites for people who like to chew ice. Like, there are so many weird behavioral things in the world.
Right.
Okay.
And it's
the hardest thing you could do is invent a new fetish at this point.
It's mostly a positive thing, too, because people who, like, might live in a small town or something and they're gay or they want to be transgendered or they have some kind of thing about them that makes them feel unusual.
Or alone.
It makes them feel different. They can find a community of like-minded people on the internet, and that can be a very positive thing. It can make, because before that, someone could just feel completely alone. Like, I'm the only one in the world who has this weird fetish,
said in your act about Comic-Con, what does Comic-Con do?
Well, Comic-Con is a community. It helps people who are into comic books, animation, popular culture, video games, find other people with type 2 diabetes. So
it's a great joke.
By the way, Frank Conniff is, like, your stand-up, and it's really gotten, it was always great, but watching you at QED the other night, your move to New York was the smartest thing you've ever done. You've become you remind me of Eddie Pepitone in that.
I'll take that as a compliment.
Yeah, it's
for sure.
You're the kind of guy who just needs to be up on stage every night because your genius comes through. And I thought in Los Angeles, you, me, not Eddie, because Eddie was getting up every night, but being in New York, it allows great comics like you to really
thrive. Well, I've been on stage more, and I'm still not on stage as much as I'd like to be, but
let me get back to pedophilia. I'm worried about pedophilia because it reminds me of terrorism.
Wait, what?
When the World Trade Center came down, although I'm a denier.
Well, didn't you go to the, didn't you take a date to the top of the World Trade Center one time?
And what happened?
Well, it was after the attack.
Oh, right. It was much cheaper. Maybe that's the joke.
No, I'm going to get in trouble for doing his joke.
Way better. No, I just fixed a joke. I took my date. I remember I used to take my girlfriend to the top of the World Trade Center. It was after 9/11 because it was much cheaper. The drinks were much cheaper. In fact, they were free, actually. They had chili. And,
did you just put a crazy straw in the reflecting fountain?
Terrorism. So certain things are off the table. When we're under the threat of terrorism, you cannot discuss certain things. When we're a nation at war, right, you cannot discuss whether or not we should be. It's unpatriotic. Okay? Are we getting there with pedophilia?
I don't understand the comparison.
Can it be that the police can charge somebody with pedophilia?
Uh-huh.
And he pled guilty.
I know he pled guilty. I know that. And I'm not saying he's innocent. But I'm saying once you're accused of pedophilia, it doesn't matter if it's true. Nobody remembers that the McMartin preschool was innocent. Right. Do you remember?
No.
And since
I don't know what you're talking about.
Since Woody Allen's only won one Academy Award since all that accusation.
Oh wait, was that shit with the recovered child abuse memories?
Yeah. What I'm saying, I'm not saying Jared's innocent. I just if the police can plant evidence.
Are we going off the rails here?
No, I know.
At first, I thought you were saying that we are in like a culture where we so profoundly condemn child pornographers or people who are pedophiles that there's no conversation to be had about like how it happens or why.
Yeah, I want to get to that.
But then you said.
It's about planting evidence and stuff like
Gene
that.
Gene Simmons' house is being investigated for child porn.
That's too bad. I loved her in Guys and Dolls.
Wow.
Okay. was George Saunders in that?
No, he wasn't, but I'm sure he worked with Gene Simmons.
Gene Simmons from his house now is being investigated.
What, the house is using child porn?
That they have reason to believe. There's a child protective task force in California.
I thought it was because they had reason to believe Gene Simmons lived there.
Okay. So now, you know, there's a task force in California whose job it is to find child porn.
Good.
Right. Yes. And the problem with that is when you have a bureaucracy, when you have a government agency whose job it is to find porn, they are going to find porn sometimes where there is none because they have to justify their job.
Wait, do you actually believe this?
I believe that hysteria can erase our rights. I think that the police planted a... I believe that Detective Furman, planted a bloody glove on O.J.'s property. I believe O.J. was framed for a murder he committed. I believe the police plant evidence.
I can't tell if you're joking or serious right now.
I believe that we have to take a step back and know that the police plant evidence, and it is very easy these days for somebody to hack your computer and put stuff on it.
Yeah, but a hack is traceable too.
Is it really?
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah.
You don't think we're running into a danger of the police?
Well, you know what we are running into danger of, and this is a whole other story that we haven't talked about, is the Ashley Madison hack. And everyone is, as was I, was gleeful to see that Josh Duggar was caught. But the whole thing, okay, it's fun to make fun of Josh Duggar, but we're all
susceptible. Do you know what he listed as his biggest turn-ons?
What?
My sisters.
So he's a family man.
I'm giving my own rap air horn for my own joke.
But, you know, everything, the idea that any of us have any privacy on the internet is just an illusion that we all have. Anything, any site that you visited, anything anyone has done can eventually be hacked, and our privacy is in danger. And the Ashley Madison, the people who did the Ashley Madison hack, they're the bad guys in this whole thing.
Here's someone I'm not worried about their rights being violated. Mm. Gene Simmons. I'm not worried about Gene Simmons' civil rights. I'm not worried about pedophile civil rights, particularly.
But we agree.
Let me finish. Okay. Let me finish. The people who most need to be looked out for are children who are victims of being forced to participate in child pornography.
Yes.
Those are the real people that need to be worried about.
Mm-hmm. I agree with you.
When it comes to child pornography, I firmly believe in the principle of Occam's razor. If it looks like a person has child porn, if the fingers point to it, they pretty much have child porn. Like,
right. And I'm going to push back on
and
that.
And I love conspiracy theories and shit, but
I'm going to push back on that because I cannot imagine anybody having child porn. I really can't.
Imagine it because a lot of people have it.
You know, a lot of people like it.
And you're not being able to imagine it is not based on any.
That's your own moral principles. Yeah. I mean, one or 2% of people are pedophiles.
How funny would it be if right now the police busted open the door to the studio and I get arrested for child porn?
That would be funny and not surprising.
And ironic.
And 100% predictable. Just actual facts.
I can't imagine that anybody would be turned on by this.
You can find David at methinksheDothProtestTooMuch.com.
Yeah, he also has a podcast called Boy, I Love Child Pornography.
Yeah, which is not that.
.org.
It's a pun. Yeah.
.org.
Boy, comma, I sure love.
Which is not as big on iTunes as you
know. Right.
Don't think I'm not worried about this because I do. I'm a champion of the First Amendment, and I do fear the police. And I'm constantly thinking: if I talk about this, will I have evidence planted on my computer?
I think you're giving them too much credit.
In other words, what I'm saying is that my computer's already been seized.
I think your life is too boring, and that's why you're making all this shit up.
In all honesty, what you just said, Colleen, and I would assume you're a champion of the First Amendment.
Yeah.
But that blanket statement gives too much power to the police.
I am 100% on board with child porn task forces. I know a woman who does it for a living, and she's a fucking awesome person.
Right. And going back to the McMartin Preschool, I'm going to be interviewing an author named Beck. I believe his name is Beck. He has a new book called We Believe the Children.
Mm-hmm.
You have, and it's about the McMartin Preschool, the hysteria of...
Well, that's a real
thing.
That's
two different things, though.
Yeah.
No. I'm
planting false memories or inventing false memories because
and planting false evidence.
I don't know the McMartin Preschool case,
but I barely remember it, so I can't speak. You sound like people after 9/11, and that's why I'm equating pedophilia to terrorism because they're both horrible things. And I worry that this. We all know pedophilia is as bad as it's terrorism, but when you talk the way you're talking, it's the way everybody talks. You run the danger of giving too much power to the police. That's all.
That's always a danger with anything. But her talking the way she's talking of the idea that the children should be the priority.
No, what she said is if it looks like pedophilia, if it smells like pedophilia, it's pedophilia and punish the person. Mm-hmm. That's what she said.
If a person has child porn...
If it looks like child porn.
I mean, I think that it's not really... you know it when you see it. Like, you know when people are doing it because they're visiting certain sites that are for that, that have like a million billion gateways.
In all honesty, I cannot believe that there are actually sites, and I've never visited one.
Well, I mean, you're berating me as though I don't believe in the First Amendment.
But here's the thing. How do we know these sites really exist? Would you dare
to go to these sites? Would you, when you're typing, would anybody?
I would if I were part of a task force and people knew that that's
so
why
we're
I was
trusting.
Going.
This is how it works now in this country. I have never, ever visited a child. Excuse me for one second.
But you're not sexually attracted to children.
No. Here's the problem. Here is the problem. I love this. I'm so happy.
So
right
fucking
now.
Annoying.
I know
on.
It's annoying. Okay. It's exactly like terrorism. When I go on, like,
because
I have,
every time you leave your house, there's an orange alert. Yeah. I know.
No. You're, Colleen is.
You've said 5 million times that pedophilia equals terrorism.
Okay.
Now what?
Okay. I am terrified when I go on the internet of hitting the wrong site. Like, I had to buy.
That's because you're old, though.
No. I had to buy my son a gift when I Googled boy toy. I was like terrified. Okay. Nobody has ever typed in a pedophilia website. Nobody has gone to one. Nobody we know has gone to one.
100% disagree with that assessment.
Have you? No. I'm talking about, this is the point I'm making. You've never been to you've never seen child porn on the internet. I've never seen child porn on the internet. Mm-hmm. You are going to trust the government to tell us what we have. We're allowed to look for this stuff. We find it. That's the only people who actually see child porn are the police.
And the pedophiles.
And we have to trust the police to tell us that there's...
Well, so what are you suggesting? A civilian task force for pedophilia?
What I'm saying is, yes, it's a problem, but I am worried that only the police...
So what's the solution, David?
We should all look at child porn. No, the... Because the problem is the McMartin preschool. The problem is trusting the police. The problem is that only police officers and pedophiles
right.
are
you said the same thing three times. Well, so what's the
so
solution?
Why do you,
a civilian task force?
I'm saying...
What is the solution?
I'm saying be very wary when Jared Fogel pleads guilty.
So you think he was forcibly... That you think it was a forced confession?
It might
be part of an overall sting against spokesmen for sandwich companies.
Yeah, it's
for
like...
For all we know.
Yeah, it could be Jimmy John's taking him down.
Yeah, Ronald McDonald might be next. But
okay, there is a law in California. Mm-hmm. We're going to get to Brooklyn, Alex. Mm-hmm. This is a great show.
Is it?
Yes. Alex,
you still haven't answered my question.
What's the question?
What's the solution?
Here's the solution. You ready for the solution?
Please.
Here's the solution.
Okay.
And once again, I'm going to talk about something that nobody else is willing to talk about. Mm-hmm. In California, there was a law passed this year that if you're a psychiatrist or psychologist and your patient tells you that you have looked at child porn, you have to report that patient to the police.
Mm-hmm.
Okay?
Mm-hmm.
I believe that the law also says that if a person says they have feelings for a child,
mm-hmm.
the psychiatrist or psychologist is on the border line as mm-hmm. to whether or not they're obligated to report.
Well, you know, there's a whole episode of This American Life about this. Have you not heard it?
No.
So there's a teenager mm-hmm. who told his mom, and then he went to a therapist mm-hmm. about it, and he like, I know I'm attracted to children.
Mm-hmm.
He's maybe like 16 and a half or 17 mm-hmm. years old now. But when this first happened,
Ira Glass is 16 and a half. Sorry.
Yeah, that's why his voice is so youthful.
His porn name is Ira Ass.
God, help us. God, help us.
Go ahead.
God, who doesn't exist, help us.
Go ahead.
He started an online, like a bulletin board for other teenagers who are attracted to children and don't want to, they know that it's wrong to act on it. And they are sort of like their own little AA group. I'm not saying that they're affiliated with a 12-step program, because they're not.
Right.
But it's a really...
That's a 12-year-old step program.
it's a really profound episode.
And what happened to them?
They're still doing it.
Oh, and they weren't arrested.
Yeah, they're trying to deal with their problem.
No, they're trying to make an awareness of it. Like, this is a thing.
That's a great thing. Yeah, to like say, oh, I have this problem, and I'm gonna. That takes a lot of courage to do that too. But you know, you can accidentally come across a site that you don't want to go to. That happened. You know, I'm like a big animation fan, right?
Mm-hmm.
So one time by accident,
you were like tentacle porn 4-year-old.
No, by accident. Just seeking out good animation, I stumbled upon the Nambla Barbera site.
So I did a series of shows about a documentary that Amy Berg directed about pedophilia in Hollywood.
Mm-hmm.
And one of the things that I learned is something that I already knew, is that pedophilia can't be cured.
No.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
No.
So in the and this makes me very angry, and this is something never discussed. And again, everybody nibbles around the edges. Mm-hmm. Here is the question. I kept asking this on the series of shows we did about the Hollywood pedophilia, quote unquote, epidemic. I asked, can pedophilia be cured? And they all said no. So if it can't be cured, they pass a law in California that says if a pedophile goes to a shrink and says,
the one you just told us about.
Yeah.
Yeah.
What do you do? So what do you do?
Well, I mean, some pedophiles are treated, they're chemically castrated. Some just rot in jail. Some are just isolated.
I think they have to be... Well, this is way too big for me to even know what should be done. But it seems that some kind of way could be figured out for people to—they're not cured, but they can control it. Now, a lot of people, not everybody agrees to alcoholism, that there's no cure for. I'm an alcoholic, and supposedly I'll never be cured, but I've controlled it, and I've been part of a program that helps.
Mm-hmm.
That's made me for almost 30 years now not drink.
Wow.
So if there's no cure for it, then finding a cure is a waste of time then. But then something else has to be figured out to help someone control something that they're never going to be.
I mean,
act on something that they're never going to be cured of.
But the
assumption that pedophilia is a quote unquote disease is very much debated.
Mm-hmm.
It's a condition, not a disease.
It's a condition, yeah.
Or is it a sexuality?
Exactly.
Yeah, it's a form of sexuality.
I mean, if you're born gay, can you be born a pedophile? And if so,
I think they probably are born pedophiles.
So you just have to put them someplace where there are no kids or young people, like the Friars Club.
That's why there's so many creepy Brazil. Old men there.
That was Alex's joke. Mm.
Very good. That's a great joke, Alex.
He looks at me with such contempt right now. Here's why.
I thought his eyes looked mirthful.
No, he's mad at me.
Oh.
This is one of our best shows. You guys, I just wish we did, we should be doing this once a week.
I can totally always depend to come in here and talk about nice, lighthearted, fun stuff.
Yeah, after a long week of writing material about racism and police brutality, it's so refreshing to come and talk about racism and police brutality.
Does any of these conversations happen on the nightly show?
Yeah. Yeah.
Where people are as stupid as I am and ill-informed?
Well, our writing staff goes from like liberal to extremely liberal, as do most
comedy
writing. Yeah. But there are a couple people who are a little bit more like fact-checky and skeptical, and people who's like the second most conservative guy on our writing staff volunteered for Obama's campaign in 2012. So, like...
Right.
But there are idealists, and there are pragmatists, and there are skeptics, and, some knee-jerk contrarians also. We got a couple of those.
Okay.
And then a couple pathological narcissists to cap it out and really make those debates fucking annoying as shit. Anywho.
Brooklyn.
Mm-hmm.
I was so hot right now.
Why?
Brooklyn, I don't know. Everyone's moving there. It's so expensive now.
Is Brooklyn another country?
Yes.
Explain it to me. Let me frame this.
Oh.
Last night at stand-up in Brooklyn, and I walked off stage. And Alex Brazil was with me, and he was furious that I quit. And I said to him, I couldn't take it. I was off my game.
You bailed on your set?
I bailed on my set.
Okay.
And I said to Alex, who's much younger than I am, that failure is important. That's mm-hmm. important to fail. And it's important to give up. That there are a lot of people who aren't going anywhere, but they're not going away. And I went away last night.
Mm-hmm.
I was just, you know, I was bad.
Mm-hmm.
And I said, goodbye, everybody.
Mm-hmm.
Isn't it important to just give up? Should, like, you know, don't we have 2 million dead Iraqis because America just couldn't give up? Didn't we destroy Vietnam because we just couldn't give up? Alex is giving me this lecture. You never quit. You never bail out. You stay in there till the end.
No.
And I said, no, I quit.
Mm-hmm.
I walked away. I failed.
I do that when I write jokes sometimes. If I'm like laboring over something, if I catch myself thinking the thought,
mm-hmm.
I know this is a good premise.
Right.
Then I have to check myself and go, Colleen, if it was a good premise, the fucking punchline would be coming. Abort.
Sometimes it's, yeah.
And then I give myself an abortion. It's so fun, you guys. I do it like 10 times a week.
It's an instinct when you're writing a joke of like, I just have the premise, but I know there's a good joke here. But sometimes you have to really
sometimes you got to just like squeeze off the end of the turd.
Yeah.
Wipe your butt and go.
Poop
jokes, guys.
But isn't it good to quit? And you talk about abortion.
The thing about what you did last night, which I assuming was an unpaid spot in a show.
Just because I'm David Feldman, and who would ever offer me money for my stand-up?
Every spot I've ever done in New York has been unpaid. But if you're being paid to middle or something and you have to do 30 minutes, then as a professional, you mm-hmm. have to do all of your time.
Okay.
Yeah, that's a good point.
You were not under such an obligation last night. So
you were under contract with yourself to try out new material or whatever, right? Yeah.
Yeah.
So
people should quit. Nobody quits anymore. Nobody quits their job.
I always quote
lots of people quit their jobs.
I always quote a comedian I used to know in Minneapolis who unfortunately has passed away, a very funny guy named Bill Bauer
Wild Bill Bauer.
Wild Bill Bauer. When he was bombing, he'd say, well, folks, I've suffered for 20 minutes. Now you're going to suffer for 20 minutes. That seems to me to be the right thing. It's just okay.
I really love it.
There's that famous, I don't know, but it was a viral video of Bill Burr like just berating this horrible audience mm-hmm. for like 20. And he said, I'm not getting off before my time is done. And he just was like telling them how stupid and awful they were. They were all screaming. It was like a beautiful thing.
I love it when people just embrace their bombinghood.
Yeah, yeah.
It can be really beautiful.
Yeah, it can be a really funny thing to just
be like, wow, you guys do not like me at all, and I am just soaking it in.
One time I was doing like a one-nighter years ago, and I was just eating it so badly. And I said this, and I knew, because I knew the reaction it would get, I said, and so, in conclusion, and it got like a huge round of applause, and I knew that was like the one response I got from the audience the whole time.
All right, we're going to wrap up. I want to tackle a couple of short issues, and I didn't see these in front of me, so I want to plow through these if we can.
All right, speed round?
We're going to speed round. Presidential candidate D's Nuts.
My favorite.
What is that? I didn't.
There's a kid, a 15-year-old kid in Wallingford, Iowa, who registered D's Nuts for president in 2016, Inc., with the FEC.
Mm-hmm.
D's Nuts is now polling at 9%
uh-huh.
in North Carolina, I think 8% in Minnesota, and like 7% in Iowa.
Do you think as it gets colder...
We did a ridiculous sketch about it last night on our show.
As it gets colder in Iowa, we'll see less of these nuts?
I think these nuts' support will shrink.
Shrivel up and not...
And, you know, everybody forgets you have to be 35 to be president.
Right, but these nuts isn't going anywhere.
Wasn't that Rick Dees' original... last name?
Rick D's Nuts. Oh, I don't know.
Two Boston men have been charged for beating a homeless Mexican man.
Inspired by Donald Trump.
Eyewitnesses claim...
Make America great again.
He heard one of the assaulters say, Donald Trump is right. All the illegals need to be deported. Mm-hmm. Trump's reaction was, I haven't heard about that. It would be a shame, but I haven't heard about that. I will say that people who are following me are very compassionate. They love this country, and they want this country to be great again. They are passionate. I will say that, and everybody here has reported it. Mm-hmm. Is this an example of why we should no longer take Trump as a joke?
No.
Like the media has been doing, and that we should start viewing his rhetoric as legitimately serious threat
to our country.
The media
isn't treating him enough as a joke, is my opinion. The media is actually treating him very seriously, and
they're softballing him completely.
Yeah, they're softballing him like what we were talking about before. He gets them huge ratings, so they give him softball interviews, and they talk about, you know, oh, well, you know, he's really appealing to a dissatisfaction in this country, and he should be taken seriously. He should be treated on, and I don't blame them for doing stories on him because he does attract viewers and they want ratings. Every story on him should be about, here's what the racist, sexist crank Donald Trump said and did today. That's how he should be treated, and he's not being treated like that at all.
Is it hate speech, Colleen? When people are being beaten up and citing Donald Trump, is Donald Trump guilty of hate speech?
Yes, he said all Mexicans are rapists.
Yeah.
He said they're raping our women.
It's hate speech that, because of him, is becoming more and more accepted every
people
day.
People love him because they agree with his racist views.
He's getting ratings, so he's not being challenged, and he's being given a forum. And it's all hate.
It's fucking disgusting.
Birtherism is hate speech.
Yeah.
Okay. GOP, Louisiana Director Jason Doerr, says he was on Ashley Madison for research. Mm-hmm. According to a recent data dump, hundreds of other government officials have been doing their research. Mm-hmm. I'm not going to do Ashley Madison v. Marbury. I don't think that joke. Maybe Colleen thinks that's funny.
I like it.
Okay.
I give it, you know, like a 3.5.
All right.
Do you know that they found a bunch of data about Chris Christie on the Dolly Madison site?
Okay.
That's a deep cut.
They also found something like 20,000 Pentagon accounts.
You know what? To me, all of this Ashley Madison stuff, it's none of our fucking business.
All right.
People are having affairs. They're being adulterous. And that's whatever. That's a drawback. That's a flaw in human nature, whatever. It's between them and their wives. It's not any of our business.
Should the Pentagon is investigating its own because thousands and thousands of Pentagon officials, soldiers,
use their work computers to go on Ashley Madison? Hilarious.
They're committing adultery when they should be committing war atrocities.
More drone strikes.
Yeah, right. Exactly.
Why
droning, less boning.
Is adultery a problem in the military?
You look like you're jerking off your arm right now. What are you doing?
Is that something that we should be concerned about with our military?
No, we should be concerned if there's not enough fucking going around. The one guy who, president we've had who dropped an atomic bomb was Harry Truman, who wasn't fucking anybody. So, you know. And Franklin Roosevelt, who was a great president, had affairs. So I'm not defending any of that behavior. I'm just saying that one thing does not necessarily associate with the other.
Yeah,
the governance and the personal life aren't necessarily intertwined. Yeah.
I believe that it is our business because I find it absolutely hilarious.
Uh-huh.
And I love it when people's hypocrisies are busted. I just find it incredibly fun.
But, you know, Josh Duggar's hypocrisy is being busted. But a guy who works at the Pentagon who's having an affair, who's cheating on his wife, however bad that is, that's not a hypocrisy. That's just a guy having an affair. He's not like Josh the fact that Josh Duggar was a part of the
That's a fair point.
On the Family Research Council deserves whatever scrutiny, but just someone having an affair, I don't think so.
Well, do you know one thing? Just sidebar into Fat Town for a second. There are like all these fake women on Ashley Madison.
I was just
Jesus Christ.
Sorry, that's what I wanted to ask you.
Don't ever say something that David was about to say.
No, no, I was going to ask you about.
It'll give him a heart attack.
Well, they like employ people to play women because a lot of people use Ashley Madison not to actually facilitate in real life affairs, but it's like fantasy play.
Oh yeah, it's like it's like talking online. With
Yes. There is no such thing.
Like only 5% of the people on Ashley Madison are actual women.
There is no such thing as a woman who will go on a website to
be a mistress.
To be a mistress, right?
There's well, the 5% apparently.
We're wrapping it up. But that's right. There's no woman is
well. It's unlikely. It's statistically unlikely.
Wants to go online and have sex with a man who's married, right?
Some women probably do.
No.
You know?
Women don't want to have
sex.
Well,
I don't think you can make that.
Okay. From David's extensive personal experience, women don't want to have sex.
We've done shows on this. I've spoken to anthropologists and doctors, and no woman wants to have sex. But women, this is a fact.
Asterisk. That
women asterisk are not David into Feldman. Sex. Mm-hmm. They're into finding sperm that will perpetuate
like humpback whales
a trait that they find
well if that's
desirable.
The case my sperm is all over the place so I can find that
yeah it's on the left
the street.
Right
yes exactly
women only want to have sex for the DNA to pass on to the next generation. Okay. Alex, stop giving me that dirty look. Malcolm Gladwell condemns Ivy League schools, Harvard and Yale, for paying I love this issue. For paying exorbitant amounts of money to private equity firms to manage their endowment.
That's
what?
In other words, $480 million. Harvard and Yale is spending $480 million a year to have their money managed.
Well, but how big is their endowment? How much is the
billions?
Well, that's like a commission, right?
Yeah,
I guess.
So what?
Yeah, I mean, that's all.
Who should be who should be managing Harvard and Yale's money?
Vanguard, the Vanguard Group.
What about Vanguard? They do a perfectly good job.
They do.
But why is Malcolm Gladwell's
Yeah, what's his
it?
Point? Where
well,
is he going?
Here's
with
my
it?
Point. If you have an endowment of like $100 billion, no money manager is going to beat what Vanguard can do for you.
Mm-hmm.
An index fund. You don't need money managers. That is a job that is...
I don't understand any of this. It's finance.
That's how you get
like,
ripped
it's,
off.
It's beyond my...
Even Harvard and Yale get ripped off by money managers.
Mm. Do we know that they're getting ripped off?
Yes, because if you have a money manager, you're getting ripped off, and that's a fact.
All of that extra money should be going to giving people who can't afford to go to college scholarships.
Look, I went to NYU, which is the world's most successful real estate company.
Exactly.
Masquerading as a
neo-Marxist
haven.
I live
haven.
In their neighborhood.
Yeah.
Which is just NYU.
Right.
You know, thanks to them, the bottom line isn't around anymore.
Yeah, that's a real shame.
All right, we're going to wrap it up. Mm-hmm. I want to thank Colleen Werthmann. How do people reach you to complain and tell you never to do this show again? You're wasting your time with David Feldman.
I had a fun time talking with you, despite how incredibly annoying all your views are.
Mm-hmm.
And I had a wonderful time talking to
you. You should have you two on the Larry Wilmore show. That would be a great panel.
If they want to get canceled. And what is your handle on Ashley Madison?
I am not on Ashley Madison.
Okay. Franklin?
I am on Assy Madison. That is my second stupid ass pun of the day. Thank you very much. People can find me at... TheFamilyResearchCouncil.com and Frank.
Yeah, you can find me at NRA.org.
Yes.
And please, if you Google me, you will see Kitty Werthmann, my great aunt who lives in South Dakota and who is a rabid anti-abortion activist.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
In what state?
South Dakota.
They don't have abortions in
exactly.
South
Dakota.
You cannot get an abortion in South Dakota.
It's extremely difficult. Extremely, extremely difficult.
Wow.
And it's doing a lot to her, which is why I love making...
Oh, wait.
Which is why I love talking about it.
Oh, she's against abortion.
Yes.
And she's your great aunt.
Yeah.
Well, she doesn't sound that great to me.
She's not. She sucks.
From the Showbriz Studios in downtown Manhattan, that'll do it for us. The David Feldman Show is made possible by listeners like you. I'm taking it easy today on you because it's the summer, but you know the drill. You know what I'm asking you to do. I'm asking you to shop on Amazon via The David Feldman Show. I'm also asking you to become a member, become a subscriber for $5 a month. I'm asking you to donate money. You know what I want. That'll do it for us. From the Showbriz Studios in downtown Manhattan, I'm David Feldman. Thank you for joining us.